Well, welcome, welcome, welcome. We are here at the Humanists of Greater Portland. We've got a lively crowd here today. It's amazing when the word's out that virtual reality is going to be here today, and we've got ability to use the machines. I'm so happy everybody is here. And for you on Zoom, you're in for a really beautiful PowerPoint that our speakers have put together on virtual reality and where it came from and where it's going, which is pretty exciting too. Thank
you. Well, welcome everyone. And as I think we all know, this is the we're celebrating this year the 50th anniversary of the Humanists of Greater Portland.
That's true.
And it was about 50 years ago that that I made a personal journey from being raised as a Catholic to becoming a humanist. And two authors that were very important in that journey were Albert Einstein and Bertrand Russell, both humanists. And what I thought I would do is this morning, I would do a reading from an essay by Bertrand Russell, which it's actually the 120th anniversary of this article. And it was published by Russell and entitled A Free Man's Worship. And I think it was one of the most powerful humanist essays that Russell ever wrote. And so I'll be reading just a small portion of it, of course. It says, "The life of man, viewed outwardly, is but a small thing in comparison with the forces of nature. The slave is doomed to worship time and fate and death, because they are greater than anything he finds in himself, and because all his thoughts are on things which they devour. But great as they are, to think of them greatly, to feel their passionless splendor is greater still. And such thought makes us free men. We no longer bow before the inevitable in Oriental subjugation, but we absorb it and make it part of ourselves. To abandon the struggle for private happiness, to expel all eagerness of temporary desire, to burn with passion for eternal things, this is emancipation, and this is the free man's worship. And this liberation is effected by a contemplation of fate, for fate itself is subdued by the mind, which leaves nothing to be purged by the purifying fire of time. United with his fellow men by the strongest of all ties, the tie of a common doom, the free man finds that a new vision is with him always, shedding over every daily task the light of love. The life of man is a long march through the night, surrounded by invisible foes, tortured by weariness and pain, toward a goal that few can hope to reach and where none may tarry long. One by one, as they march, our comrades vanish from our sight, seized by the silent orders of omnipotent death. Very brief is the time in which we can help them, in which their happiness or misery is decided. Be it ours to shed sunshine on their path, to lighten their sorrows by the balm of sympathy, to give them the pure joy of a never-tiring affection, to strengthen failing courage, to instill faith in hours of despair. Let us not weigh in grudging scales their merits or demerits, but let us think only of their need, of their sorrows, the difficulties, perhaps the blindnesses that make the misery of their lives. Let us remember that they are fellow sufferers in the same darkness, actors in the same tragedy with ourselves. And so when their day is over, when their good and their evil have become eternal by the immortality of the past, be it ours to feel where they suffered, where they failed, no deed of ours was the cause. But whenever a spark of the divine fire kindled in their hearts, we were ready with encouragement, with sympathy, with brave words in which high courage glowed."
Richard, that was the epitome of being a humanist. Just beautiful. Thank you so much. That was lovely and truly appreciated. And thank you. I'd like to now introduce our speaker, because we're going to have fun. This is going to be a really fun day. They've prepared for us so well. Matthew DeMoss works for ITFiniti. He's been working with computer science for over 12 years. He met Del Allen at an Apple store, and they've been fast friends ever since. He lives here in Portland, is a lifelong Portlander, and he lives with his mom, and they're Pomeranian, and is very proud of the fact that he helps his mom and is here with us today. Thank you. Thank you so much, Matthew, for being here. Yeah. Okay, well, then I'm going to hand over the reins to you.
Good morning, everybody. My name's Matthew, and my associate Tyler here behind you to your right. And thank you so much for having us here at the Friendly House. We're excited to share some of the things we've learned in our explorations of virtual reality, and I'd love to demo that for you today. So virtual reality can be a very fun, safe activity, but if you suffer from epilepsy, please let Tyler know, because we have ones that are very flashy and we have ones that are not. We have a three different demos that will be available for you today. One of them is a wildlife safari. It's very comfortable. You simply adjust the headset and you'll be looking around, seeing elephants and seeing the savannas in Africa. But it's very hands-off. You'll just get some of the practical feeling of being in VR. The second opportunity we have is a space adventure, where you will have some motion control. If you feel comfortable enough to use the handsets, you'll be able to actually grab the controls in your spaceship and interact with objects floating around you as you take a journey through the atmosphere. And finally, we have a very hands-on. If you really want the full experience, we can put you through understanding all of the controls and the ability to actually move around a little bit. And that one's the most fun, but also a bit intimidating. So just let Tyler know which one of the three you'd like to do. He's going to come up one by one and just bring people over to try out the experience. Don't feel pressured if you don't want to try it. You can also wait if you want some other people to go first. We do sanitize the equipment between each person, so you don't have to worry too much about contamination. And yeah, thanks so much for being here. it's our pleasure to share with you our understanding and experiences. We're going to talk about the history of VR, the different models that are now available in stores, what you might do with it, be it entertainment, or whether you'd like to see the practical uses of how virtual reality is affecting our economy and the landscape of what we do in our day-to-day lives. So while I go through this slideshow, Tyler's just going to grab people one by one, so you don't have to raise your hand or anything. He'll just come to you. I'd like to reiterate what King Henry said to each of his many wives, and that was, "I shall not keep you long." What is virtual reality? The computer-generated simulation of three-dimensional images or environments that can be interacted with in a seemingly real or physical way by a person using special electronic equipment. Usually this involves a helmet with a screen in front of each of your eyes. And it involves a handheld gloves or controllers that you would hold. To quote the Oxford Dictionary, the definition of virtual reality is images created by a computer that appear to surround the person looking at them and seem almost real. So the physical equipment in most of today's VR systems requires a headset. A lot of them are going to come with the controllers, and some of them are going to come with these base stations that use lasers to identify where you are and where your hands are. So the lasers have to be usually in the corners of the room, and the lasers interact with the headset and the controllers. It used to be you need a very large computer to run these things. And we actually demoed this for you guys about 5 years ago in around 2017, 2018. And we had to haul really heavy computers up the stairs, and we had wires going everywhere. And then we found the lasers don't interact with the sun well, so we had to close the curtains. Since then, the technology's changed a lot. There's now portable ones that just have a headset or just a headset and controllers. Many modern ones don't require the heavy PC anymore, which is very convenient for new users who maybe don't understand computers but would like to use the virtual reality anyway. So we'll talk a little bit about where virtual reality came from. And that is, I think it started in 1832 with the stereoscope. It's a fancy little wooden device, and it simply divides your vision to allow different depths. So you would have two very similar images, but they're not quite the same. And our brain is actually able to fuse those images together and gives us the illusion of a third dimension in a flat image. The stereoscopic images are made as one pair, one seen by the right eye and one seen by the left. The earliest stereoscopes, both with reflecting mirrors and with refracting prisms to achieve this effect, were invented by Charles Wheatstone. And that was constructed for him by an optometrist, R. Murray, in 1832. But stereoscopic photo viewers only engaged our sense of sight, and that was leaving a lot to be desired. And so in the mid-1950s, Morton Helig developed the Sensorama, which was a kind of a full cabinet machine that was supposed to encompass a lot more of our senses, not just sight. It was a mechanical device that includes a stereoscopic color display, so that gives us that depth perception. It had fans that would blow air on your face. It actually had fragrances built into it to simulate the smells that you might have, and vibration of the seat so you could feel sensations of your body as well. And so its most popular simulation was a motorcycle ride through New York City. And it would have you sit on this imaginary motorcycle while you went down the street, and the fans would blow smells of hot dog stands, of exhaust from cars, to give you that real choking sensation. And it would rumble, the seat would vibrate, giving you the feeling that you're really there on a motorcycle going down the street. So this was a big leap forward from just a little wooden, with just engaging your eyes. But it was not very portable, and it wasn't very efficient at what it did. And the simulations were very hard to create on there. And then the military got involved. When they found out the applications of this, they reached out to Ivan Sutherland and his student Bob Sproul to create a head-mounted display. This was in 1968, and it was called the Sword of Damocles. It had to be suspended from the ceiling because it was so heavy, your neck couldn't hold it up straight. And the computer required to run it was fairly advanced. As you can see in the background here, it was the size of a couple file cabinets. And the most that it could simulate for you was a wire frame. So it just was like solid lines that would kind of frame out what a room might look like. So not quite as exciting as the Sensorama. But as it reached public domain, the race began for it to be commercialized for entertainment. And while two big corporations picked it up, one ran with it. Sega of Japan created a patent and got in the game first. But after a few years of development, they actually dropped out of the race, deciding that they couldn't make this come to market. Nintendo, however, did go forward, and in 1995, they released the Virtual Boy. The Virtual Boy was the first ever portable console that had true 3D graphics. It was capable of displaying 3D images and marketed as a form of virtual reality entertainment. Most video games used kind of a monocular cues to achieve this illusion of three dimensions. So it wasn't quite the same as a previous technology. It was actually using an illusion of depth with a process called parallaxing. And that's where you overlay two images of different colors to give the illusion. And we would know this by the early 3D theaters where you had the red and blue. Little paper glasses you'd put on. It was that same technology being used here on the Virtual Boy. The display consisted of two-bit or four shades of monochrome red, and the resolution of the screens were 384 by 224 pixels, and it moved at a speed of about 50 hertz. It had a little oscillating mirror inside of it, and it used red LEDs to create the effect of a screen. Unfortunately, this caused the images to be very jumpy, and it could be very uncomfortable to stare at. And Nintendo finally decommissioned it, saying that due to a lack of color, they felt that it wasn't getting adopted at the rates that they would like. And so they discontinued production. But now we're in the 21st century, and I want to talk to you a little bit about some of the modern consoles that you might see in stores today, things that are advertised. And of course, the one that we're demoing today is included in that. Tyler and I have been interested in it since we were young, although it's only very recently that we were able to purchase our own systems. My first experience was actually at Tyler's house playing on his HTC Vive VR headset. And it was very magical for me. It was like being in the Matrix. You know, you're walking into a computerized world and you have no idea what you're going to see. But what I did see was awe-inspiring. We used Google Earth to visit locations around the world, to be able to see the streets of Paris, to see the pyramids up close, or even just to fly through the air and feel the experience of floating. We played video games where we saved the world from artificial intelligences, and we we created incredible artwork where we would draw pictures or repaint rooms to our liking. And so while we're going to show some of that capability in the demos today, I'm going to put up on the screen here the first and our favorite console. So as you may know, Facebook has rebranded as Meta. And so this is the Oculus series of headsets put out by Facebook's Meta company. They have the advantage of being wireless, which is a very big first in modern VR technology, because you don't need to own a computer that might cost you thousands of dollars just to operate it. And this kind of opens it up to anyone that would want to give it a try. It's a market leader for these reasons, and it comes in at $399. You can pick it up locally at any Best Buy, Walmart, GameStop, or order it online. They come with 128 gigabytes of storage, which is not a lot. And for $100 more, you can double that storage. They use USB-C to power and to transmit data. If you do want to run something from a computer, that's still an option. They have two displays in them that are 1,832 pixels by 1,920. And it has a refresh rate of about 90 hertz. So it's just enough to keep you from getting sick while staring at it. Next up is Valve Corporation's HTC series, or Index series, I'm sorry. And this, I own this console as well. It is a huge hassle to move it and to operate it, but it's incredibly different from the Oculus. It comes with a lot more features. They run about $1,000 for this console. And while they're still widely available, you do need a PC in order to run it, preferably something fairly new. It sports independent speakers that actually are hovering off the ear. And this allows for sounds to appear as though they're moving around your body. Instead of headphones that stick in or cover the ear, they actually float and are not touching you. And this gives you the illusion that something is moving, like a rotoscope might be able to transmit a sound. This one comes with these tracking units that we talked about with the lasers. And while they're a little bit difficult to use because of sunlight, if you can get a dark enough room or just shaded, that usually does the trick. It allows it to be a little bit more accurate in tracking your body's motion, where you are and where your controllers are. Lastly, we have the PlayStation VR. If you're a fan of PlayStation and you own a PlayStation 4 or 5, this is probably the least expensive and easiest console to get started with. It comes in at just $300. It can be found in any stores locally and online. It seamlessly works with the PlayStation console to either enhance your games by giving you more control of what you're looking at, or some games even allow you to use controllers in a different way and like pilot a starship or explore a building. The PlayStation VR I haven't used yet, but I do highly recommend it. It has a 1920 by 1080 resolution and a 100-degree field of view. The OLED screens they use are first in class. They're really, really beautiful to look at. And so now that you have some ideas about virtual reality and the kinds of consoles, we'll talk about what they could be used for. And then we'll talk about the practical uses. People use VR for watching videos. They use it for online dating, creating art, and of course, playing video games. When I had first gotten into virtual reality, we learned that you could emulate some older software. So there were cell phone games, computer games, or console games that you could play on even the early virtual reality that was kind of entertaining to revisit those things from a new perspective. But we'll talk about movies first. And so a lot of you have probably heard or used Netflix, and they actually have an entire library of movies that are exclusively for use inside a headset. Yeah, it's a fairly entertaining experience because while you're usually just staring at a small box screen in front of you, now everything is opened around you and you can see things happening behind, in front, to either side of you. It definitely takes advantage of speakers as well. If you have a surround sound system, it's going to enhance the quality of where you think an object is and keep your attention focused in different directions. So I would highly recommend the experience if you do ever get into virtual reality. Download the Netflix app and check out some of their movies that they have available there. Another nice feature is for movies that are not fully 3D, that you can't look around in all directions, they can still give you theater experience. And so a regular movie, when the VR headset is on, could be blown up to the size of a cinema display. And that adds some value to the experience in that maybe your TV at home is not that large and you'd like to see it bigger. And so there's a... There's now online dating, and everyone's kind of heard of how you could get together on the internet or use a cell phone app to meet up with someone. But if you would like to keep your privacy, and maybe you would like to date from within the confines of your home, and you also maybe don't want to share personal information, even to the extent of your own picture, like you don't want them to see what you look like quite until you get to know them. Well, online dating is more prevalent than ever, and with virtual reality, you can go on a date with someone without sharing any personal details from the comfort of your home. You're actually absolutely right. You'll create an avatar, which is a version of yourself, the way of which you would like to look. And while this could be used for nefarious purposes like catfishing, I trust none of you would do that. But understandably, the other person is doing the same as you. It's as though you're at a masquerade party and you're all wearing your masks. And you get to choose when the mask comes off and they get to meet the real you. But in the meantime, you can go out to a picture together and actually look at each other during the movie, at least the avatar form of them. You can hear each other's voices if you like. And then you can go out to somewhere to share a meal, although it's virtual, you won't actually be eating. The feeling is still somewhat real. Well, that's the nice part about virtual reality. There's no check to pick up. I suppose you could purchase an experience to do together and you'd have to decide who pays. So there's a company that's now capitalized on this and assists people with creating that avatar and breaking the ice where they meet new people. And they have multiple ways to do it because it may be a little intimidating at first. Some people would like to have a crowd to choose from and others would like to be matched with someone of their preference. This company is called Planet Theta, and their business model boasts unparalleled privacy, and they claim that they can match you within minutes, and if you don't like the person, you'll never see them again. I'll go ahead and read a quote from their site. The basic concept of our matchmaking is simple. Users jump into a micro dating queue, and our algorithm sets them up on a short virtual reality date with other users who meet their criteria. And that could include your age, it could include hobbies or other preferences. If you enjoy chatting with that new person, you can extend your date into a coffee shop where it's more private and then continue on to send messages and share pictures if everything is going well. But if not, then you can immediately move on and go on to another blind date and they'll keep the ball rolling. This is the reason that Planet Theta exists. They know that for free, you can go meet whoever you want, but then you can't vet if that person is real or if they're just a computer or if they're just someone trying to steal your personal information. Planet Theta's job is to identify that you're a real person and that the people you meet are real people and keep you in an environment where you can't be scammed. And so that would be one reason for a paid service such as that. So we've talked a little bit about entertainment purposes, and we'll kind of wrap that up with art. And this one, I could never do it justice, so I'm just going to show you a short video clip here of the kind of art that you can create. This is a program put out by Google called Tilt Brush. This is a popular application among hundreds that are available. But some of the features that you could expect in virtual reality art programs is the ability to paint in three dimensions. You can work with all kinds of architecture. You could import buildings or even scan your own house. And then you could treat all of your walls like easels, explore different paint jobs. You could bring your car into the virtual reality and repaint or put decals to see how your car might look. And it's just a one of a kind of experience that I wouldn't know how to put it to words, because it's so incredible the things that you can, your imagination will just come up with on the fly once you're in there. Quite similarly, video games would be a bit of a hard one to describe, but this, I believe, is widely one of the most popular video games out there. It's called Beat Saber. It's a great exercise program. It's a great way to kill 5 minutes and get a workout at the same time. And so what it is you import or download one of their songs, and then objects move towards you with the rhythm of the song, and you have these controllers in your hand that you are able to tap with the beat. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Yes, I was wondering whether you had any insights on when Apple's virtual reality headset's going to be coming out.
Yeah, I've been watching them for a decade now. They actually have a patent gone through the patent office for the technology, and yet no announcement. It's been all crickets from them. But my guess is that Apple is working on something truly incredible, and they watched Google when they released the Google Glass, which is a set of glasses with recording and some virtual capabilities. Well, that was a huge flop, and it cost Google a lot of money. My guess is Apple took that to heart, and they held back. So we'll likely see their product in the near future, but as to when, who can say? I'll show you real quick here what Beat Saber looks like. This is just an advertisement for a regular game, but it shows you kind of the different angles that you would see. you can see in the short span of maybe a 3-minute song, you get a great workout and have a fun time. It's very popular because it's accessible and you don't need a lot of understanding in order to play the game from the get-go. But we'll move on now to more practical versions of uses for virtual reality. The entertainment industry gobbled it up, but it's certainly far from the only uses out there. Virtual reality is being integrated now into military programs. It's being used in schools for primary education. It's being used in workforces the world around to train people to do their jobs better, faster, and more efficiently. It's being used now for remote medical procedures. You no doubt have heard on the news that surgeries can be performed from across multiple cities, where a surgeon will be using a virtual headset to guide a surgery for a city they're not in. There's even treatments now for phobias and PTSD to help people readjust with something that their mind can't handle. And we'll start with the military applications. The U.S. military has been using virtual reality since the 1960s in association with the Philco Corporation. All branches of the military now use some form of virtual reality for training. Sometimes it's augmented, where it's just a screen that overlays information, and sometimes it's a full headset that encompasses the experience. But often this is used for exercises that are either too rare or too expensive or too dangerous for someone to commit to in real life. If you have a helicopter or an airplane that's going to crash, you don't want to simulate that in real life. It would be far safer to put the pilots in a scenario where they can respond accordingly without the risk of being in a real aircraft failure. It's useful for mechanics in order to learn complex equipment that would be more ideally done hands-on, but in a classroom, you'd be able to have, say, a piece of equipment in front of you that otherwise isn't available for every student to be holding. But with a virtual headset, they would have access to be able to take apart and learn about this equipment in a safe environment at a much cheaper cost than purchasing lots of units for each person. There's also in the medical side, there's difficult surgeries from combat wounds that are difficult to simulate, and virtual reality gives the opportunity for a combat medic to understand what sort of situations they may be working in and what sort of injuries they might have to treat on the fly. And then we'll talk a bit about workforce and child education. A very popular use in primary education now is for virtual field trips, where it may be too expensive or inaccessible to have a bus take children to an event. They could tour a museum or go to a zoo or visit somewhere that would otherwise be too prohibitive to get a classroom to. Having a bunch of headsets, a school would be able to rotate through classrooms and have accessible for all students, much like computer labs used to do and still do. And companies have begun doing the same now. There's some wild claims about the efficiency in training that you can give a virtual workforce. When COVID hit, a lot of people had to move to working from home, and this made classroom education for companies very difficult. But by shipping a headset to the user at home, they'd be able to interact in a very lifelike way with their associates, as well as learn on-the-job skills that they can't be physically present for any longer. So it's had a great amount of retention now, and more companies are picking it up. On the medical side of things, in 2015, Dr. Nadine Hakakaram performed her first remote live surgery on a bomb victim in Gaza, but she was working from her home. And in 5 years, her technology is now spread around the world through companies like Proximy and Immersive Touch that have made this accessible to hundreds of hospitals. They also now have therapy that is called VRET, or Virtual Reality Exposure Therapy. And it helps to decrease the intensity of a stress response to a situation or a thought or a memory that might provoke anxiety or fear. And so for somebody who has a phobia of spiders, this would allow you to comfortably see a spider at the other side of the room and know that it can't touch you and it can't hurt you. And through repeated exposure, the spider could get closer and closer until eventually you're okay with it crawling across your arm. You won't feel the spider because it's not real, but this tricks your brain to adjust and acclimate you to have less fear when that happens. And so that would be a very simple and mild example. It's now being used to treat serious conditions, PTSD from soldiers who've come back from war, or my personal favorite, people who are afraid of needles. And maybe you have to get immunized or you have to get a checkup and you know a needle's involved. Well, this is a great way to acclimate to a needle without having to actually get stabbed. It helped a lot of people in that area. But we're sitting just on the tip of the iceberg when it comes to this technology. By the end of the decade, I imagine that we're going to see things like 8K screens. The current screens we see in Costco or on shelves are 4K, but we think that they're going to double in resolution, and that for each eye. Wi-Fi is advancing ever quicker. We now have access to Wi-Fi 6 technology. This would allow you to stream much more complicated environments to a headset, which will be required if the graphics become more intense on them. We're seeing now haptic feedback, which is still in exploration. Haptic feedback is, say, for example, this glove. It would allow you to feel a sensation like hot or cold, a textile feeling, or it would allow you to, say, reach for an object and grasp at it as though it's there. And the glove will actually restrict your motion, giving you the illusion you're grabbing an object. This technology is very far out. Haptic X is a company that is currently demoing the products, but they run about $18,000. And they're far from perfect. But I believe by 2030, we won't see just gloves, but entire suits that would allow you to feel full sensations and the restrictions of actually being in that environment. Slightly sooner than I thought it would be here are the infinite treadmills. This is a device that allows you to walk, crouch, stand, sit, fly, or run in place without leaving the comfort of your home. It has a strap that comes around the waist, and its pillars are strong enough it can hold your entire body up so that you can lean forward and float vertically. It will also lower down to allow you to crouch or move into a sitting position. And allegedly, it can handle sprinting. So if you're able to run, you would be able to run as fast as you can, and it would keep up with your motions. I haven't gotten to use it myself yet, but I would imagine that the shoes are a pivotal part of what makes this work. This unit in particular can be ordered for $1,800, and it's available for use with all major headsets. They claim that the accuracy is within 0.12 millimeters, which is just crazy to me. They say that you can move in 360 degrees. You have free locomotion to move in any direction that you choose. But this is one of the exciting technologies we're seeing emerge now. As for beyond that, we're seeing AI integration. We're seeing artificial intelligences that are integrating with virtual reality and able to create simulations that we could only dream of before without the need for a human programmer. You would describe something to it and it could create a simulation based on what you told it. This technology is still very experimental, and there's a lot of ethical questions that come with that, but I don't have too many of those answers yet. Anyways, I'd love to take some questions today, and definitely we'll keep running the demos to allow everyone to get a chance to go through.
Okay, well, we do have some questions. We're gonna have some questions here, Matthew. That's, that'll be fun. Yeah. Okay, Todd Kimball, I see your name, so come on in.
Well, thank you, Helen, and thank you, Matthew, for an outstanding presentation. You really piqued my interest in a field that I had kind of dismissed so far. So thank you for that. Two quick questions. I think they have quick answers, so I'll ask them both. So many different headsets to look at and different applications to try. Is there one store or one place you could recommend that would give us the best experience to figure out which headset would be best for us?
Absolutely. I would advise that you stop by a GameStop or a Best Buy and look for a demo that you could try. This would give you an easy way to experience it without too much cost. Although I'd have to say personally, I do recommend Facebook's Oculus, partially because it's inexpensive at $400 and partially because they don't require a lot of advanced knowledge to get up and going. I think you could purchase it, open the box, and in 10 minutes, you'd be experiencing what you want to experience.
Great. Second question. I was really intrigued by the PTSD applications, especially for a friend of mine. Is there a company or an organization that would be a good starting point for that to see if it might work for them?
Yeah, I don't know what medical programs are offering this, but I'd love to grab your email address and then email you what I do have on that.
Okay, I'm happy to put it in chat. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, that's fine. Thank you.
I do know that the Oregon Burn Center uses virtual reality. They did a study where they would put a virtual reality headset, very basic, was developed in Seattle at Harborview. And it was, they threw snowballs at snowmen, but it was a cooling activity. And they would, it was a silly little game, but they'd wear it during dressing change. And they really did help with pain. It helped. They did the clinical research with it at several units, and it decreased pain during dressing change. I've been gone from the unit for a few years, so I imagine that they've gotten more programs now. I mean, different programs, but it was a pretty cool thing. Hank Robb, you have a question. You're on Zoom. Come on in.
Yes. Years ago, when I discovered holograms and holographic presentations, I said to myself, I'd like to live long enough to have Shakespeare performed in my living room. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that holographic technology has been superseded by the kinds of experiences that you're describing. Do you know anything about making holographic images appear where you are versus having to wear a headset and the kind of technology you've been describing? If so, I'd like to hear about it.
Yeah, I was still researching this myself, but a company in Japan has created what we would like to think of as advanced holograms. They use it for stage shows, and as I understand it, it's tens of thousands of dollars and does require a large crew to operate. However, it can make a three-dimensional image of a person appear and move around as though that they were real. You can't touch them as they're just lasers comprising them. But I understand they don't need smoke and mirrors to make this work. You may have seen in a lot of novelty stores now, they'll have a sheet of glass that's fairly transparent or a cube of glass, and they're able to make a 3D image inside that. I've also seen the smoke and mirrors where you can have lasers shining into a cloud of smog that will give the illusion of depth for a 3D image. But there is a company in Japan that's managed this without either of those, and I don't know yet how they do it. I'm guessing it's a closely guarded secret.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, if I can find sources on that, I'd be happy to send you everything I've got.
Thank you again.
Yeah.
Al Christians at Friendly House has a question.
Yeah, you're kind of focused on virtual reality here. I wonder if anybody's trying to use this technology for like real reality, where I could put on one of these mask things and just, you know, go through my normal life, and it would be my normal life, only better. Are there technologies, are there things like that are coming along too?
Integrating virtual reality with real reality there's sort of two applications to it. The first is called AR, which is augmented reality. This is the approach Google was going for, where you would have glasses much like these, and they would overlay information over the real world. This could tell you if your milk is spoiled just by looking at it, or it could tell you if your laundry is done just by looking in the dryer's direction. So there's some applications there that could enhance one's life, and we're certainly looking forward to new iterations of that. As for living your life inside virtual reality, I feel we're very far off from that still, because the objects in it aren't real, so you can't really feed yourself. You could set up a room that mimics your real room and add elements that are not actually there. So for instance, you would tell the virtual reality your couch is there, and then when you put the headset on, you know it's safe to sit there. But you could also then have, say, a giant TV that you don't actually own displaying your streamed content from Netflix. So you're sitting on a real couch, but you're wearing a headset looking at a fake screen. And so that would be a way that you could sort of augment your real life with a virtual life. However, I believe that's mostly the extent of it at this point. There's not a lot of good tracking technology for smaller objects yet that would allow you to live a comfortable life. You know, if you were to open your fridge, mapping each thing in your fridge would be nearly impossible. So you would have to take the headset off to proceed.
Yeah, I thought of this question when you were telling us about the education, you know, the museum that the kids would visit virtually.
Oh.
But if they believed it was real, it wouldn't have to be real.
Right. Being able to go to a museum and view statues and works of art is a great example, because they don't usually let you touch those in the museum anyway.
Great. Kathy Moy has a question. Come on in, Kathy.
Hi. I have a more technical question. I wear glasses, and I also, when I got my cataracts replaced, got monovision. I'm wondering what is the distance of the real focus when you use these things?
It will vary from headset to headset, but they do have almost all of them come with a manual adjustment to help acclimate it to your eyes. And some of them now allow you to interchange the lens of those eyes with your prescription glasses. So if you have a glasses prescription, some of them you have to put the headset over your glasses, and others you can actually change the lens and order customized ones. But the distance, if that was your question, from the eyeball has always been adjustable, because for some people you need a bit more or less.
So you are focusing on the screen and not the object you're looking at.
Correct. And it's an optical illusion that actually uses circular screens. So they're cascading out like a ripple. And this gives us that parallaxing effect of things being overlaid over one another. But the way I understand it is your eyes are still focusing on a screen that's a mere inch from away from them. So for myself, I can use it comfortably without glasses, as I don't have a problem reading up close, but I have a problem seeing far. But as the screens are very close to my face, I don't have that problem.
Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh.
Roy, do you have a question? Yes, Roy from Friendly House.
My question got answered, but I just now had an experience with the virtual reality, and I had the simplest, easiest one. And it was fantastic. I was in Africa, and this elephant walked by me within a few feet. He was massive. And I was a little bit afraid of being crushed. And I could see his skin and the cracks in the skin and all that. If you're here, make sure you get out there and try it.
Roy, were you seated? Were you seated during the...
No, I was standing.
You were standing, okay.
Yeah, but in the reality, I was seated in a canoe.
Okay. So did you feel at all imbalanced?
No.
No, okay. Felt very balanced, okay. All right. Dakota, you're on Zoom. Come on in.
Thank you. Good morning. Would you consider yourself optimistic about how far this sort of technology can go within the next few decades or centuries, or do you believe it'll cap off at some point within the near future?
Absolutely not. I think that the technology will continue growing. And my My reasoning behind this is cellular phones. It used to be my father would carry this giant brick around and hold it to his head, and I had no idea what he was doing. Nowadays, I can't stop doing that. And I believe that if the technology continues adapting in a way that's comfortable and easy to use, society will adopt it, and the money will be poured into future research to continue advancing them. So I think that before the end of my life, we'll actually have chips inserted into our head that give us a wireless connection that you could then, close your eyes. Now you're in your virtual reality. I don't know that that will be the future, but I anticipate it.
So do you, from that statement, you see your body kind of becoming part of a computer, like augmented by a computer?
It already is. I call this my second brain.
That's true.
It remembers things perfectly. And when my wife says, "I told you that," and I say, "No," she shows me.
Yeah.
And if there was a safe, comfortable way to adapt that to your brain instead of a phone, I think that a lot of people would take that.
Okay. Lori Benton has a question that I'm going to read. And Lori, if we need clarification, I might call you in here, but I've used other people's PlayStation VR and wanted to get one. I thought I had to get one that used my Android phone, but apparently not. Is the Oculus now called MetaQuest 2?
That's correct. I do apologize for the confusion. Facebook has rebranded as Meta, and so they also call it the MetaQuest instead of Oculus as part of their branding. And also the PlayStation virtual reality, I believe, is usable with some Android phones, but it is definitely compatible with the PlayStation 4 and PlayStation 5 models.
Okay. Lori, was there anything else you wanted to ask there? Is you're getting ready to make a purchase?
I should mention they're about to release a new iteration of the PlayStation VR. So definitely get a good deal on a used one if you want the older one.
Okay. All right. Dave DiNucci has a question.
Okay. I was wondering with the Google Glass thing, I mean, it came, it went.
Yes.
Do you know what the issues were that kind of made it so that it wasn't accepted by the public or wasn't able to do what it needed to do? And is it coming back?
I've heard two myths regarding it that I find to be highly likely. I don't remember what Google's official statement was other than that it is unprofitable, which a lot of companies use just to cover up because they don't want to admit mistakes other than that. So the two reasons that I've heard, though, are that they're not very stylish. They didn't come in a variety of shapes and colors, although they may have if they were adopted widely. So the people wearing them felt kind of awkward, and they were usually called out for wearing it. The second were privacy concerns. Google Glass was designed as built on spyware. There was a constant live feed coming if you didn't put a piece of tape over it, and Google would be viewing the faces of anyone you viewed. In fact, anywhere you wore the glasses, they were capturing that content. And the UK privacy laws are very aggressive against that now. So I think Google saw the difficulties and lawsuits coming and decided it wasn't worth it.
Eleonora, you have a question. I think you're on Zoom. Come on in.
I just want to let you guys know my associate Tyler has to step out for a minute, but is coming right back. And because we have a great big audience today, he's actually going to set up a second headset and then we can have two people going at once.
Okay.
But he'll be back in about 15 minutes.
Okay. Eleonora?
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah, clearly.
Great. I have sort of two questions. I have like a zillion, but I'm going to stick to two. Is this technology potentially going to like substitute like laptops or phones where you could access, you could do a Zoom chat on it, you could have, your workspace in it? Is that something that's happening? Are there benefits? My second question is, is there like eye strain on the user for like overstimulating, like sort of all the optics that are happening? Are people experiencing like, issues with their eyes or like just too much focus? I'm just thinking about how much it's, you know, stimulating that sort of some of the senses versus other ones. So those are my two questions. Thank you.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. There is some strain involved. And actually, the second question answers the first in that I don't know anyone who can reliably keep the headset on for 8 hours. So you couldn't practically get through a work day unless you were kind of putting a strain on your head and your eyes. Many, many, many different things have been done to improve comfort, from rebalancing using the back and top of your head instead of just the front to redistribute the weight. They've got different silicone or rubber or other liners that will touch your face to try to reduce the friction or drag against your skin. You're jerking around looking at different things. But none of it has made this something you'd want to wear all day. Some people do still report getting very dizzy, even if the frame rate is high and the screens are of the best quality. Your brain is still sensing there's an uncanny valley and something's not right, and it causes a bit of queasiness. So even for myself, after about a half hour, I feel that I want to take it off for a while. I do know that classrooms and workplaces can have their employees and students keep it on for an extended period, but I think probably around 3 hours is the longest anyone should be in there at a given time.
I have a question from Kathy. I have a camera with the optical zoom. I took a photo of my state senator from across Pioneer Square. So we've already lost privacy. She's looking.
You missed the fact that it's 65 times zoom.
Oh, 65 times optical zoom. Yeah. So we've already, we have lost privacy.
My cousin works for a camera company, and he quit when he found out that the cameras they created were used for government spy satellites to zoom in and capture personal information from U.S. citizens, which was a huge breach of privacy. I don't know where that's gotten in the courts, if it ever went anywhere, but you're absolutely right. Not just the military, but private citizens can now use optical zoom and recording to kind of capture data that they should not have. The UK has caught on to this and has some very intense privacy laws that can land you life in jail. I don't believe the US currently has an equivalent on video and photography, but they do for audio. So if you say something that's recorded, that can be prosecuted, but I don't believe videos or pictures can yet.
Do you envision homes being like the way a home is built changing as this virtual reality becomes part of just an integrated in the family? There, the kids would be maybe taking some school courses through virtual reality, or people working more from home. Do you see changes, physical changes in a way a house is put together?
Currently, I don't think that's happening too much because they're becoming more portable, which encourages you to kind of use them wherever you're at, whether that be at school, at the library, or out in a public park even. Mm-hmm. However, I do have a client who constructed a room entirely for VR purposely in their home. I've seen arcades convert whole rooms into VR rooms now, and even some businesses that all it is giant empty warehouses where you put on a headset and it's got a cable manager that follows you around. I don't know that this will reach out to everybody's homes in the near future, because I think there's more portability is more important to us. And just like brick and mortar businesses are suffering, I think establishing rooms for a single purpose also is not going to be practical.
Okay. And, you know, currently you go to a movie and you see the movie, you sit in a chair and you see the movie and enjoy it. And some, 3D movies, but will the day come where you'll go to a theater or a special place and you'll be literally on an adventure? It may be dangerous, but you'll be safe. I mean, where you'll completely simulate an activity that's completely virtual.
There's a AAA video game title called Fallout, and it's about the world after a nuclear apocalypse. Your goal in this is to survive, find rations, and this has been adapted into VR. When I first played it, I got fairly hurt because when someone started shooting at me, I thought it was real, and I jumped into a wall. So we encourage safety, that you're practicing is safety. But yes, I think adventures such as that are already here, where you'd be able to explore a vast world for hundreds of hours and be entertained the whole way through.
Wow.
I see where virtual reality is really a fantasy world.
Yes.
And I have seen instances where in years gone by, people were actually almost absorbed mentally by their computer because they could push a button to make something happen.
Yeah.
Will there be or are there limits to creating virtual reality to the point where people will retreat into it and reject true reality? And I see this as a threat to young children growing up. And I see this as an area where we should be able to be developing some sense of caution. If we see the way the internet has been exploited. And I just see this as another hitch to where we're going. There's a fascination with creating a reality of your own. And I could be attracted to that. But I'm concerned about the loss of true reality and interpersonal relationships.
I absolutely agree with you. Limitations should be placed, and especially on minors. This activity should be monitored and closely guarded, because there is a lot of there's a lot of scamming. There's a lot of catfishing that goes on, and a young person will likely be able to go places they're not supposed to. They'll figure out how to break the fail safes, the passwords, and explore to their heart's content. So I would encourage monitoring, and people older, 18 and older, to be very cautious about what they accept as reality. My brother is a graphics designer, and he can make very lifelike characters for virtual reality, so much so that you might feel as though you're interacting with a real person that is, in fact, not real. I entirely agree with you. I don't know if this should become a government-regulated thing, but I definitely would caution individuals to limit their experiences and be careful with what they're seeing and taking from these.
Great. Al Christians has a question.
Okay. Back around 1995, I was working on a big project to put insurance companies on personal computers. Big deal. High tech, millions of dollars and all this stuff. And one of the guys who was working on this project said, oh, we're just riding on the tail of technology. He said, technology is driven by two things. He said, games and pornography. That's it. And he had a whole list of things that would never have happened, that wouldn't have been possible for us to do any of this stuff if games and pornography hadn't come along and made these personal computers really cheap. Now, with your technology, what percentage of all the money that's making this thing happen is based on games and pornography?
I couldn't tell you.
You wouldn't tell me.
I couldn't if I wanted to. Public figures would probably put that very high, but military spending in the country is, I think the U.S. spends more than the top 10 countries combined, and a good portion of that is on research and development. And so I would assume that a lot of money is being spent on developing practical uses for the military. But in the commercial realm, you're absolutely right. Video games and entertainment, and especially pornography, are huge leaders for this technology. And a lot of people are apt on developing it further to see how far they can go.
Okay, now the military, does the military still have the rule that once you've learned something on virtual reality, this was years ago, again, back in the old days, you can't touch the real hardware for 3 days because you have to get readapted to real reality before you're safe. Is that they still have that kind of a rule?
I actually was unaware of that. I want to look up and research that now, because that sounds like a really good idea.
Jules, I noticed that you have your hand up. Can you come in on Zoom?
Well, the gentleman before Al, who gave that wonderful summary about the facing up to the reality that is so important that we keep alive rather than immerse ourselves totally, regardless of all the good feelings, all the new experiences, etc., really rang a bell with me. It sort of preempted anything I have to say that makes any impact. But nevertheless, I still want to give you a sense. If I was sitting as I did in an audience listening to Joshua Bell play a Mendelssohn violin concerto, and look at him and listen to him and feel the energy and love in that room for that fabulous music, why would I want to substitute anything else? Even though you could tell me you could make it around, you could turn it upside down, I could touch the violin, who cares? I just want to enjoy that concerto. I don't need it. And maybe I'm a lemming, and maybe my age is showing, but is it really that necessary to go that far in changing our perception of what is really in front of us?
I would like to see virtual reality used more for the disadvantaged, because there are people that maybe can't go to a live concert. And if they don't get that opportunity in the real world, a virtual replica, while inferior, might be their only way to do it. But I personally would much rather go to the opera myself. And any virtual reality experience had to have been captured, at least currently, from a real creation. So okay. Someone still had to play the songs that go into that program.
Hmm. Well, that makes me feel good. Thanks.
Yeah, it won't invalidate those things. I'm sure it can't replace them. It just makes it more accessible.
We have a question from Jake at Friendly House.
Hi, yeah, this is more of a comment than a question in response to some of this. I just push back a little bit against the apprehension to people getting sucked into VR as a totally kind of fantasy, fictitious space. Because a lot of the ways that I've seen VR used in my circles has been to interact with people more, especially in terms of like when COVID was going on and everything's shutting down, people don't feel very comfortable being around each other physically. VR really opened a lot of doors in terms of like, now you can go to the movies with your friends and not be worried you're gonna get sick and like that kind of stuff, as well as like you were just mentioning, like maybe you can't go to the opera, and now the technology to kind of get close to recreating that experience is getting very, very good.
Oh yeah.
So yeah, that's my comment. Yeah.
Well, I mean, looks what's happened, Jake, just this last 2 years. Yeah. We were all in person, 100%. And then we thought we were over. And then when COVID hit, yeah. And then we, because of these wonderful volunteers, Dave and Mike and all these folks, we said, well, let's go on Zoom. We're not going to end. Well, we've got half our audience on Zoom and half our audience here. And we miss the connection. So a lot of us are here, but there's some folks that are far, far away. They couldn't possibly be here. So yeah. We've already entered that world a bit.
Also, I think why VR is so appealing is because it's closer to a real experience than what a lot of people are getting in like other kinds of like video game spaces, for example. Yeah. Like I know one of the really cool ones that I kind of came across recently was it's a scary game, Resident Evil is what it's called, about zombies, and that kind of similar to the old Sensogram or whatever machine you were talking about. You can play the game in VR, and they sell candles with the game that you can light that will give the kind of musty horror house smells. So that you can really immerse yourself in the zombie apocalypse. But yeah, kind of fun.
Well, Matthew, I've got, now, do you have children?
No.
No, and Jake, you have a little yeah. one. Would you mind going back, and then just real quick, go back to would you let your kids, your son, I mean, do you let your son eventually get on all these things?
Yes, I have a Valve Index, and his favorite game is Beat Saber.
Okay. Richard, do you have a question?
Well, I just wanted to mention, I don't know, maybe for the older members of the audience, Isaac Asimov wrote a series of robot novels where he talked about the spacers and this was a culture that never interacted in person. They had weakened immune systems, and they could only interact virtually, essentially. And so it was an entire culture based on virtual reality and having holographic projections. And of course, that was, he wrote that in the 50s, I think it was, when the and probably didn't anticipate COVID, but in a situation like this, it's really quite remarkable that we're finally entering an era where that is becoming practical in terms of if someone, say, has a weakened immune system, can't interact with people, they can still get out in the world and do things.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I have several friends with schizophrenia, and real world interactions can be very tricky for them. And supervised, we're able to make outings work. But if they're not supervised, they usually have to stay home. And that's kind of a shame. But this gives them the opportunity to go into a situation where they can just, at the push of a button, leave something that's too distressing.
We're going to have our final, Renga's got a question, Joyce. Hang on 2 seconds. Renga, can you come in here?
Okay. You talked about the AI being integrated into this one. Then what happens to this mix of real reality and virtual reality? What sort of problems is it going to create?
Well, I hope that it only creates positives, but it could create a lot of problems in that people may use the augmented reality where they're overlaying information on real sight, what they're actually seeing. And I know that the military can use this, you know, almost like infrared to commit terrible atrocities because they're able to get more data and perform things without having to be there.
Also, we don't know what exactly the military does, and it is all secret. So we don't know what things are happening there, which maybe already they may be at it, right?
Well, the fact that they were using satellites to spy on us tells me they probably are doing a lot of terrible things with that sort of technology.
And there is nothing much we can do about it.
Not yet. What you can do is vote, and your voice matters a lot. So if you're just keep looking at the measures and laws being put in front of you and the people, and vote according to your conscience.
Thank you, Matthew. Our final question is going to be from Joyce Lackey.
You mentioned that you have several friends with schizophrenia, and we're playing with the brain here.
Yes.
So is there any possibility that this sort of thing can trigger some mental illness?
Absolutely. Yeah. And the only beautiful failsafe is that you can quickly take it off if it does, but I think a lot of people can be disturbed, and that's one of the warnings we had to have is for epilepsy, because a lot of experiences include flashing lights, and that's something that will trigger the brain. Agreeably, yes, you could view an experience that might, for the instance, when I thought someone was shooting at me with a gun, I would never jump into the wall unless I thought I was in real danger, and my brain, as fake as this all was, thought I was in real danger, so I leapt for cover.
Well, Matthew, this has been so informative and lovely. I'm going to close now, and we'll have a few announcements.
Yeah.
Would you be able to stay for, we have an afterthoughts, which is where people, it's more in, much more informal. We move to another room.
Yes.
Would you be able to stay for afterthoughts?
Absolutely. And we'd love wonderful. To get two headsets running so everyone will get a chance to tour this until the program's over for the day.
Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.